Welcome back, everybody. My name is Frank. I'm the instructor of this course. I know it's been a long time since I've seen you and you've seen me, and I really miss that. But regardless, today, let's talk about correlation. Think about that word, correlation. We're trying to find the relationship, the co-relationship between two variables. And when there is a relationship between two variables that we have discovered, it gives us a lot of information. Think about our current situation. There's been a pattern discovered between a person's age, that's one variable, and the severity of symptoms that they suffer when they have COVID-19. That's the second variable. So just try to view this in your head. As a person's age increases, as we're talking about older people, those people tend to suffer more severe symptoms. As a person's age decreases, as we're talking about younger people, those people tend to have less severe symptoms. Now, when we find a pattern like that, we have a correlation. And what we can do is quantify that relationship. And we will do that by computing what we call a correlation coefficient. A coefficient is just a number. We will compute a correlation number, known as a correlation coefficient. And then we will test it to see if it's statistically significant. That all comes just a little bit later. For right now, I just want to introduce to you some preliminary issues. And first off, it's really important that you understand the distinction between correlational research and experimental research. So let's start right there. One thing that makes an experiment unique is that we manipulate one variable and we try as hard as we can to control all others. Let me give you an example. By now, most of us understand that smoking can do damage to your health. But that wasn't always the case. We didn't always know that. So let's take ourselves back several decades, and let's assume that I'm a researcher, and I'm interested in studying that particular issue. Now, because I have some sense that smoking might harm human beings, I'm going to study animals instead of human beings. So I'm going to order some mice, and they all have essentially the same genetic background. So they're not clones of each other, but they're all relatively similar. Now, I need to create two groups, because I'm going to have one group of mice exposed to smoke and one group of mice that is not exposed to smoke. And eventually, I want to compare those two groups to see what happens to their lungs. So how do I determine which mice are going to go into each group? I'm going to use random assignment. So I'm literally going to do something like flip a coin. So here's mouse number one. I flip a coin, and it turns out heads. That means that mouse is going to go into a cage that's going to be inundated with smoke. Now I have mouse number two. I flip a coin, it turns out to be tails. That mouse is going to go into a cage that has no smoke. I'm going to do that to all the mice until I have my two groups to be compared. One group is going to be in cages with smoke. One group is going to be in cages that have no smoke. Now here's a really important point. I have manipulated one variable. However, I want all other variables to be controlled. So I mentioned to you that genetically, they all started out very similar. There's one thing that I can control. Here's another thing. You know, it's possible that a person's health or a mouse's health can be affected by what they eat. I'm going to make sure they all eat exactly the same food and exactly the same amount. I'm going to make sure they eat at exactly the same time of day. I'm trying to control as much as I can. So what's another thing I can control? Exercise has something to do with a person's health or with an animal's health. I'm going to make sure they get the same amount of exercise each day. I'm going to manipulate the cage such that they're forced onto their exercise wheel at some point during the day, and then we're going to turn that exercise wheel on so that it's spinning, so that they are forced to run on that wheel for something like 30, 40 minutes a day. But I'm going to make sure that happens to every single mouse in the study, no matter what group they were assigned to. Do you see what I'm getting at? I've manipulated this one thing, smoke, and I've held all other variables that I can control constant. So now I'm going to let like 3-4 months go by, and the mice are going to be living their lives in their cages. But in that one group, I'm going to be pumping smoke into those cages. So at the end of 3 or 4 months, we're going to stop the study. And I know you hate to hear this, but we're going to dissect those mice, and we're going to look at their lungs. And let's say we find that the animals that were exposed to smoke have much more disease in their lungs than the animals that were not exposed to smoke. If this was the case, we would be able to conclude that smoke causes damage to lungs. So if you think about it, an experiment is really kind of a simple thing. I'm simply trying to isolate and test one variable at a time. Between those two groups, there was just one variable that distinguished between them, and that's that smoke was present in the lives of some of the mice, but not in the others. Experiments in that regard are brutally efficient. They help us learn the truth in a really fast way. And because we control all other variables that we can control throughout that study, we limit the possibility of other potential explanations for our results. So, for example, someone might attack my results, and they might say, like, well, your results are really interesting, you know, but it's possible that they were exposed to something else. There was something else in their environment that was toxic, and that's what actually led to the damage to their lungs. And I would say that's very unlikely. I designed these cages so that all of the mice, regardless of which group they were in, they all had the same type of experience. The only thing that differed between those two chambers is that one had smoke pumped into it. And they'd say, yeah, you know, that's really interesting, but you know, what an animal eats has a large effect on its health as well. And it's possible that the animals that were exposed to smoke, they just weren't eating as much. And I'd say, no, I actually controlled for that too. All of these animals were fed the exact same food in exactly the same amounts. So do you see my point? Do you see the strength of an experiment? Experiments are wonderful things. I know this is a grim example, but experiments are amazing things at proving what causes what. Let's compare experiments with correlational studies. Correlational studies are often known as observational studies, and that's because in a correlational study, we don't have any of the control I just talked about in a true experiment. I'm simply observing things and then taking measurements. So let's talk about a correlational study involving smoking. Let's use human beings, because remember, I'm not going to ask people to smoke. I'm not going to manipulate anything. I'm just going to measure people. I'm going to observe people. So when I say observe people in this situation, we would probably observe people via a questionnaire. I'm going to ask them questions. So I can easily ask people if they smoke, and if they do smoke, how much they smoke per day. I'm going to have a measurement for each person on that particular variable. And then I can have some medical assessment done on their lungs. So, of course, I'm going to need some type of grant money or something like this. These things can be expensive, but I'm going to have them go in and get chest x-rays or maybe MRIs. It depends on how specific we need this study to be, but eventually I'm going to have an expert rate how healthy their lungs are. And let's say that I find at the end of the study that the more a person smokes, the less healthy their lungs appear. So in other words, I found a relationship between smoking and the health of the person's lungs. But this is where things get a little bit complicated. We need to understand that correlational studies, simply because of how they're designed, cannot prove causation. And that's because in that correlational study that I just described to you, we cannot isolate and test one single variable at a time. Let's say that somebody tries to attack my study again. So they say to me, like, well, your research was really interesting, and I know that you found that people who smoke more tend to have less healthy lungs. You know what? It's also possible that these people were exposed to something else in their air, something else where they live, and that's what caused the damage to their lungs. And you know, people who are smokers, they tend to be people who have less money. They're lower on the socioeconomic scale. And people who are lower on the socioeconomic scale, they tend to live in situations that are less healthy. There might be more pollution, for example. Did you control for that? And as complicated as that all sounds, I'd have to admit that no, I didn't control for that. And I guess that is one possibility that I can't rule out when I'm trying to understand my results. So what's the bottom line? The bottom line is that correlation can't prove causation. Because we can't isolate and test one variable at a time, because I can't control for all of those other extraneous variables, there is always some other potential explanation for my results that I can't completely rule out. That's a really important lesson to learn. So make sure you really think about that and make sure you understand it. But this is an equally important lesson to learn. Correlational studies are great. They have great utility. Even though I can't prove causation, I can still learn that there's a relationship between two variables. And as I mentioned to you before, when there's a relationship between two variables, to some extent, I can predict one variable from another. That is amazing. That has great utility to us. That provides us with a lot of information. So when you realize that some information that you're learning comes from a correlational study, don't think to yourself like, oh, correlational studies stink. There's nothing we can learn from a correlational study. No, there's lots we can learn from a correlational study. We just can't prove causation. I mentioned to you that we will compute a correlation coefficient, and a coefficient is just a number. We have computed Z values, T values, F values. Now we are going to compute an R value. A Pearson's R. It's a very common type of correlation coefficient. That number that we compute will represent the average relationship between two variables. It can be positive or it can be negative. It will range from negative 1 to 1. So in that sense, it's standardized, and it becomes very easy for us to interpret because the range is restricted from negative 1 to 1. The only difference between a negative correlation and a positive correlation is the direction in which the variables move. Let me give you a quick example right now, and then on one of the following slides, we'll go over a couple more examples. When there is a positive relationship between two variables, it means the two variables are moving in the same direction at the same time. When one variable increases in value, the other variable tends to increase in value. Now, the flip side of that is that when that first variable decreases in value, that second variable also tends to decrease in value. That is a positive correlation. Let me give you an example of a positive correlation. Taller people tend to weigh more. Shorter people tend to weigh less. That's an example of a positive relationship between two variables. Here's another example. The more you study, the higher your grades tend to be. The less you study, the lower your grades tend to be. That is an example of a positive correlation. Well, as I mentioned, that correlation coefficient can be negative as well. When we find a negative correlation coefficient, it means that the two variables are working antagonistically. As one variable increases in value, the other variable tends to decrease in value. So let's look at a couple examples like that. The more alcohol you drink, the less able you are to drive a car. Do you see how that's a negative relationship? As alcohol consumption increases in value, your ability to drive a car well decreases in value. If we have a correlation coefficient equal to zero, there's absolutely no relationship between the two variables at all. So in other words, we can't predict one variable from another at all when there's a correlation coefficient equal to zero. Let's talk just a little bit more about the nature of these relationships. You see that I said that a correlation coefficient represents an average relationship between two variables. An average relationship between two variables is different than a deterministic relationship between two variables, two or more variables. Let's look at this example first. Distance equals speed times time. That's a deterministic relationship because once I know how fast you've been traveling and how long you've been traveling, I can compute exactly how far you've traveled. That's a very rigid or deterministic relationship. This one you're probably less familiar with. People used to say, I guess back in the day, that one pint equals a pound the world around, and it was just some way to kind of estimate how much some vessel would weigh if it was filled with some type of liquid like water. Because I guess one pint of water equals 1.04 pounds. And what that means is if I know exactly how much water is in some type of a container, I know exactly how much it weighs. So it's kind of a strange example, but it's an example of a deterministic relationship. Statistical relationships are average relationships. We're not talking about something that's quite so rigid. The stronger the relationship, the better we can predict future events. So remember I told you before that taller people tend to weigh more and shorter people tend to weigh less. And you might say something to me like, you know, yeah, but, you know, my brother, he's like 6'6 and he's like a string bean. He weighs 135 pounds. And I'd say, well, that's great, but that doesn't negate what I'm saying. I'm saying on average, people who are taller tend to weigh more. And on average, people who are shorter tend to weigh less. So it's an average relationship. So the stronger the relationship between two variables, as I mentioned, the better we can predict one variable from another, the better we can predict future events. So for example, I know there is a reasonably strong relationship between scores on exam one and exam two. So after a student completes exam one, to some extent, I can predict how well they're going to do on exam two. So if a student struggles on exam one, I can predict that they're going to struggle on exam two unless they get some additional help. Do you see how it gives me a lot of information? It gives you a lot of information. What do you think that you would find right here? This one we've talked about, height and weight. We would find a positive correlation. Smoking and cancer rates. Do we expect that we would find a positive correlation or a negative correlation? Let's talk it out. So the more you smoke, what's going to happen to your risk of getting cancer? Your risk of cancer is going to increase. The less you smoke, your risk of cancer is going to decrease. So this would be a positive correlation because the two variables are working in the same direction at the same time. Increase smoking, increase your chances of cancer. What about this one right here? Exercise and heart disease. Let's reason it out. The more you exercise, the lower your risk for heart disease. The less you exercise, the higher your risk for heart disease. Do you see how that would be a negative correlation? Because the two variables are working antagonistically. As exercise increases in value, your risk of heart disease decreases in value. What about this last one right here? Money and happiness. Let's kind of reason it out. So if you have a ton of money, are you really happy? Not necessarily. If you have no money, are you really sad? Potentially, particularly if you can't afford food and a house. This is an example that I often put in to try to help you understand that sometimes relationships, although they exist, are not necessarily very strong. And what that means is they're not necessarily very predictive. There is indeed a positive correlation between money and happiness. So if we simplify it, we'd say the more money you have, the happier you are. The less money you have, the less happy you are. But it would not predict happiness very well at all. What's driving that relationship? Mostly people on the low end of the money scale. If you're not able to pay for food, if you're not able to pay for a house, it's pretty hard to be very happy. But when you look at people who are billionaires, millionaires, compared to normal people like most of us, they're not necessarily any happier than we are. So although there is a positive correlation between those two variables, it's a relatively slight correlation. And what that means is we could not predict very well a person's happiness from their money. So I hope you've got a general understanding of what I'm talking about here with correlations. In the next video, we'll go into it a little bit further. And what we will do is graph the relationships between two variables using scatter plots. So I'll see you in the next video.